Hi everyone, it is so good to be back with you today. We are happy to be back on the My Consultant YouTube channel to once again provide you with some updates in the immigration world. A quick reminder that any immigration consultant connected to myconsultant.ca is a licensed and regulated immigration consultant and legally able to provide immigration advice. Please always make sure that you use someone that is regulated and competent. My name is Neerja Bhandari and I have with me Rupali Gulati today, and we are both licensed practitioners. We are both RCICs. Hi Rupali, it's nice to be with you today.
Hi Neerja and hello everyone. It's great to be back here and it is so good to be with you all. Well, the landscape of Canadian immigration is always changing, and nowadays it's more than ever. Even for practitioners who have been associated with the industry for a long, long time, it is really impossible to stay on top of things nowadays. Every day I'm checking for new updates and new changes. And guess what? The surprises are now never ending, from a 75-point draw to a TR to PR pathway and to a number of other things. So therefore, the name of the game nowadays is that all consultants and all people with immigration matters, to be sure to check in for the latest updates and information first. Like, that's the way to start the day nowadays. For example, the other day, Neerja, did you know that IRCC provided new guidelines in the OP manual called Assessing the Applications Against the Policy Conditions, that is the TR to PR policy, with a re-emphasis that the applicants must meet all the essential criteria for selection. And this time, the guidelines came with a bit more detail. So for all practitioners who are looking for details, it's a good time to go to the OP manual. And if they are seeking clarity, they will find the clarity there. We are all aware of the eligibility criteria, legal presence in the country, the required CLB scores, the experience requirements, the three categories, the fact that self-employed people do not qualify under this category with just very few exceptions, and so on and so forth. We know that there are these are quota-based programs, and there is a real-time update available, which is great, and all of those other things. But now we have an extra bit of explanation and more clarity with the OP manual being updated. So out of the three categories, which were the category for in the TR to PR pathway, category A was the essential workers of the healthcare industry. Category B was the essential workers of non-healthcare industries, non-healthcare occupations. And the third category was international graduates. And of course, there were Francophones. So of these three, we are getting real-time updates, and guess what? Which one vanished first? Which one was filled out the first? 40,000 international graduates. I think that was gone within 3 days. For the other two, category A, we still have, I think I had the time where some, I had the update somewhere here on my screen. Yeah, so for category A, which is the healthcare workers in Canada, the quota was 20,000 applications as of this minute, as of 11:15, quarter past 11 today. They had only 1,559 applications which had been received by IRCC. For the non-healthcare workers, out of 30,000, they have received 10,513 applications. So we have a good about 20,000 sitting there, where if we have clients, we can submit their applications. Recent international graduates, well, we all know it's gone. But the hope is that it is anticipated. There is word, of course, there is no confirmation yet, that this might reopen. They might extend the quota. There is word that students, international graduates, will get another opportunity to be able to reapply. So that's about that, Neerja. I believe you have some quick reminders and updates for us for these pathways.
Yes, so before I give a quick reminder, I'm giving hope to the eminent applicants and consultants who have clients who could not get through the last time 40,000 applications were in, that don't lose hope. I keep telling my clients to at least appear for the language test, collect their documents and wait, because there is hope that this might open again and they will have a chance again to apply for it. The quick reminders would be that in this new pathway program, TR to PR, refugee claimants could not apply. They could not meet the requirements. Yeah, and you must do the general test for CELPIP or IELTS. It's not the academic that you require. New factors that were listed for consideration for self-employment and employees. More of this in the second YouTube that we will have, next YouTube video we'll have. But basically, people who are self-employed do not qualify for this program. You have to be employed. You have to meet the definition of being a worker in Canada, which is being employed full-time on a payroll with an employer in Canada while you're legally in status. Employment while being on maintained or implied status is considered eligible as long as the same conditions from original work permit are maintained. A lot of people worried about it, but let Rupali and me tell you that a lot of students did not understand that they could use their work done while they were student. They could use that as work done and legally acquired work experience for the essential workers category. What do you say on that, Rupali?
Yeah, there was a lot of confusion about, you know, generally speaking, I think at the back of our minds, we always kind of have the CEC criteria in mind for international students. That's kind of fed into our system that we always think about the CEC selection criteria. So under the CEC program, when you have any work experience which you gained while you were a full-time student in Canada, does not lead to any eligibility consideration towards the CEC program. Now, this is where the TR to PR pathway is different. For individuals who obtained work experience while they were international students in Canada, and they obtained this work experience due to their authorization to work 20 hours a week, will be able to use this work experience towards eligibility for the Stream A or Stream B. For the recent international graduates from a Canadian institution, there is no essentially work experience requirement per se. All the requirement that there is that they need to be employed. But for category A and category B, that is workers in the healthcare industry and essential workers in the healthcare industry and essential workers in the non-healthcare occupations, they could use the work experience that they earned as students to contribute towards their eligibility. Now we only need to remember that the difference is that full-time experience is 30 hours a week, and these students would usually be working 20 hours a week or lesser. So that calculation is a different story altogether. But yes, it is now clear that that experience can certainly be used, which is you know, in my mind, great news, which is fantastic news, because it makes it easier for so many international graduates to be able to use their work experience to qualify, which is very nice, I feel. So this was this, and Nisha, do you remember we were discussing something else just before the session started about another nugget to be taken away? That one was that this part-time work experience can be counted, and the other one was, yeah, of course, it was that for the medicals, if you're able to book your medicals, fantastic. If you're not able to book your medicals, then the government made it very clear that they would accept an e-medical information sheet, however old that might be. If you have one, if you did medicals once upon a time and you have an e-medical info sheet to prove that, you can use that.
You can even use an appointment that you have booked and it is still, you're still waiting to get your medicals done. So if you have booked appointment and you have proof of that appointment booked, you could use that also to upload currently. Mm-hmm. That is another thing that you could use.
And, you know, there is also a lot of information every single on every day basis about the program. And for those who already have applications in process, now we can see firmer procedural guidelines, clearer procedural guidelines in place, and more thorough instructions. The beautiful part is that I think starting yesterday, applicants are beginning to receive AORs, acknowledgement of received letters, which is like wonderful. That is really fast for their applications that they submitted under the TR to PR pathway. So I would imagine that in the next few weeks, practically everybody would be having some very substantive update towards the processing of their application. So IRCC has promised fast processing on these, which is kind of a good thing, because in this pathway, there is no bridging open work permit pathway. So we don't have that bridging thing. So we are all hoping that the finalization should be as fast as possible. And in that light, the receipt of the AORs is great news. I still think it is wise to counsel all our clients and set the expectation in our minds as well as theirs, that although IRCC will make all efforts to expedite the processing, still this is likely to take many months, and not to really expect anything too fast, lest, you know, every department is currently working under tremendous strain and dealing with tremendous volumes. And IRCC has an immigration quota this year of 401,000 immigrants, which is like a huge one. So while they will try their best, I'm very sure they are probably allocating as much resource as possible, and they are probably trying to do their very, very best. And yet this is a huge volume, so it's best to be mentally prepared that, you know, it might take a while.
So Rupali, what do you think? How soon can you anticipate another opportunity for international students?
Well, there is no confirmed word on this, but now that you have thrown it at me, I kind of have a feeling that we will see another opportunity, at least I hope to see another opportunity for international students towards the end of the third quarter.
And between the two of us, we have seen, and I'm sure we've all seen, there is a lot of debate still going on. Yeah. About the signatures on these applications.
Oh, like, yes.
was all the forms required to be signed, or was it only okay to sign the disclaimer at the end? So there's a lot of confusion over that.
So which school do you belong to?
So I belong to the school that if they had signed my form saying they have used a representative, I'm happy with that. The validation of the IMM 0008, that is the generic form, and at the end they have the student themselves, the postgraduate student themselves, have signed the disclaimer that everything they have submitted is correct. And
so you are a believer that the end signature in the online portal is the one that takes care of all signatures, and then
yes,
the
because
only
this
document...
application was submitted by the clients themselves.
Yeah. So the only signed form that needs to be there is the signed use of rep, making you their authorized representative. So you belong to that school of thought. I also am from the same school that if the use of rep is signed and the client at the time of submitting their application did the digital signatures and made the disclaimer that they are submitting everything, and that one digital signature serves as a blanket signature covering the entire application. So of course you and I belong to that school, but there is another school. There are practitioners who have diligently believed that every form needs to be filled, printed, signed by the applicant and scanned, and the scanned copy needs to be uploaded. Oh, well, I would say time will tell, right? That either they are correct or both of us are correct. There was also, two different feedbacks from IRCC on the website and from IRCC on Twitter. somebody posed this question. Actually, a number of people posed this question about signatures. And on their Twitter handle, IRCC said it a number of times that only the blanket signature at the end is required. However, the website very clearly said that no. Every individual form except the IMEI generic needs to be signed. Now, whenever there's a disagreement between what IRCC is saying on a social media handle, on their social media outlets, and on the website and in the manuals, well, then the social media takes a backseat. What takes precedence is what is on the site. But it is something yet to be seen.
But for due diligence, I was making sure that if the client is adding extra sheets to their Schedule A forms or any other form, then they were signing and scanning those forms back and uploading them to make sure that they don't miss anything and they're not held responsible for not giving the information in the correct format. So then they were definitely signing and scanning them back. But if the form was complete in itself and validated, then we were not signing them.
Oh, well, so that's that about the TR to PR program. And I'm sure there will be more in the coming days. And I wish and I pray for all the best for the international students who are waiting for another opportunity. And Neerja, you were going to tell us something about the PNPs, right?
Yes. On a humorous note, COVID has made us all lose our humor. But I'll make COVID the butt of my humor and say that COVID has been it has been a blessing to a lot of people in Canada who otherwise would not have had opportunity, but it has opened opportunity because currently Immigration Canada is not inviting people from outside Canada the way it used to in big volumes. So currently Immigration Canada is being very generous and I feel the provinces are really opening their doors to everybody.
I noticed that too, yeah.
We are seeing very generous and very regular draws from British Columbia, from Saskatchewan, from Alberta, and from Ontario PNP. And we've recently had a draw this week of 500 applicants in the express entry PNP draw. So I would suggest everybody should give those options to people who are outside Canada, their clients who have less points, but they qualify in these programs. So create that expression of interest for different provinces because this is the real good time for provinces are inviting everybody. And COVID is proving a blessing for a lot of people. So I'm not letting it put me down.
Yeah, of course.
And I'm making sure it works for my clients also. It works for everybody who's having good dreams to come to Canada and have a wonderful life that Canada can provide them. Because Canada is an opportunity provider. It's a land of opportunity, good life, good people around. And as an immigrant, I can vouch that I feel very happy as a Canadian.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, of course. There is another piece of news, and this one is a bit removed from from mainstream immigration, and yet it is associated with immigration. On the 25th of May, the Office of the Information Commissioner of Canada tabled a report in the Parliament, which talks about the access to information requests which are made to IRCC by applicants, by practitioners, an interesting fact came out that while the number of access to information requests made to IRCC is always significantly more than the access to information requests made by people to any other government department. But then in 2019 and 2020, IRCC received three times more access to information requests than, wait for this, all other government institutions combined. And yes, no surprises. We can't find the status of a file. We can't find something about something going on in a file. The only way to find out at this time is to file an access to information request. And obviously, with COVID, with the slowdown, with the lockdown, you know, with altered processing let's say with altered processing methods, you know, whatever had to be adopted in light of the pandemic. The number of ATI requests received by IRCC went up significantly. There was a whopping increase. So therefore, the Office of the Information Commissioner of Canada launched an investigation to better understand the dramatic increase and why this is happening. And then the Office of the Information Commissioner made a recommendation to IRCC to challenge the status quo, the current situation of receiving that many ATI requests. And they were asked, IRCC was asked to revisit how they handle information requests. And all of this happened on the 25th of May. And then on the 26th of May, IRCC launched a formal effort to streamline and modernize the access to information, a new way to process the access to information request, and to kind of address the fact, to look into the reason that so many access to information requests were being made, such a whopping increase. So what is the crux of all of this for us as practitioners? The crux of all of this for us, and which is a happy conclusion, is that we are probably looking at IRCC changing the way it releases information to practitioners and individuals, applicants, which means that we can hope for having more updated and more prompt and more detailed information available to us about the processing of applications, about the steps of processing, about what is being done, so as to minimize the need for filing and access to information. This is not mainstream immigration news, but to me, this is very, very significant, because this means that my client is going to see more and know more about what is going on with his or her matters at the department. So far, we are limited in knowing what's going on with a file, right? And which kind of very clearly explains why the number of ATI requests is so high. So the one takeaway, the one real good that is going to come out of it is we are probably going to see more openness, more transparency, more availability of directly relevant information to the client in the coming days.
That's great. So that means we can hold our clients' hand more tighter than before.
And I know.
Take them through the process. And hopefully immigration will keep throwing more opportunities for people who have so many beautiful dreams, who settle here, who are already integrated and invested into the society here, who are here on work permits, study permits, and they're looking forward to opportunities. You cannot take away what happened when, even with people who had lowest score of 75 in Canadian experience class, were invited to apply. So that was a fantastic thing. And I think I fell in love with immigration all over again, that they're giving so much opportunity to immigrants. And I hope it keeps doing that, because it gives us opportunity to bring more and more people to Canada who actually want to be here and invest themselves here and be part of the society here. What do you say, Rupali, on that?
Absolutely, absolutely. It's a good thing that immigration is opening up, and opening up in bigger and better and more ways. And we all look forward to a brighter future. Our industry throughout COVID has only gone up and up and higher and higher. And, you know, I think that's a great indicator of the fact that immigration practitioners, immigration consultants are doing a good job and will continue to do a good job. Well, I hope all of you gained a bit of insight today. We wish you all good luck with your immigration journey, and we encourage all of you to seek correct information, correct guidance, ensure competent counsel, and keep asking all your questions. We invited you back to this YouTube channel again for further updates. We will keep giving you further updates as we go. And let's hope that we are looking for a more open world, a more open Canada in the coming days. And all the very best.
Absolutely. We're not giving up on anything. We are striving and we are striking back, and we will all do well. And hopefully everybody does well in future too. Stay happy, stay healthy, and stay safe. And hope to see you again. Keep following KPIC on YouTube for more updates. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pali.
Thank you, Neeja. Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.